In 2016, I travelled between London and Lisbon. The sleeper train starts in Paris at noon and arrives in Lisbon in the early hours of the next morning, crossing the borders while its occupants sleep. When I embarked, the previous inhabitants of my bunk had left a book in the net that strings along above the sleepers' heads. The book was Derrida's collection of lectures of hospitality. I began reading in the soothing rocking of the train and the gathering dusk. The book addresses the question of the foreigner, the stranger, at the level of the individual and of the nation state. The previous occupant had scrawled marginalia, exclamation points and furious underlinings, dog-eared pages. I read with interest. I had just become an immigrant on paper in the United States. A guest, an official alien, conditional on good behaviour listed in the fine print of my new papers. While the country from which I'd come was staking a new identity on turning away those that were arriving at its shores. As I turned the pages of the book, I dislodged, from somewhere towards the back, a folded piece of paper. Slightly glossy to the touch, one side jagged where it had been torn from a larger hole. It was an article about the nematomorpha, or horse hairworm. Here's what the article described. The larva of the zombie parasite nematomorpha develops inside the body of a cricket, eating its way through everything non-essential to the cricket's basic functioning. Once grown, the worm needs to return to water to reproduce. Having eaten its fill and having reduced the cricket to head, shell, and legs, the hairworm begins to secrete mind-controlling substances, driving the cricket towards and then into the closest river or lake. The cricket drowns, and the hairworm emerges from the corpse and swims away to mate. In a particularly romantic twist, this clipping suggests that the hairworm waits for a moonlit night to take over the mind of the cricket, using the reflection of moonlight to guide its host to a watery grave. This year, immobilized by a virus, I travelled instead through hyperlinks, scrolling through my phone in the cold dusk. I came across a paper published by two scientists in Japan who'd been studying this nematomorpha, or horse hairworm. Their research found that when they considered these zombie parasites not just in relationship to the cricket, but to the wider ecosystem, the hairworm became a vital pivot point in the flow of energy. Those crickets leaping into the water provided a food source for an endangered trout and prevented the trout from eating too many of the bugs, which were food for the local bird population. This paper on the nematomorpha, they said, provided the first quantitative evidence that a manipulative parasite can dramatically alter the flow of energy through and across ecosystems, reimagining the function and possible roles of the parasite. Altering the flow of energy through and across ecosystems, driving the empty shell of the nation state to a watery end. I print the findings and imagine when foreign objects are no longer a site of contagion and fear, when travel is possible again, that I will leave it on the seat of a plane, slipped into the bag of the traveller next to me on the bus, distributed among the rooms of a cruise ship just before departure, or once again in a net bag above a bunk, a gift, a clue, an earworm, a potential parasite in this strange shared domestic space of a sleeper train crossing borders in the night.
To start off, I would like to present these incredible micro etchings and ink paintings by neuroscientist and artist Dr. Greg Dunn. Unfortunately, science often carries the stigma of being boring, and neuroscience is no exception, but Dr. Dunn turns this stereotype on its head. By translating scientific literature into artistic expression, Dr. Dunn shows that scientists can be and are creative. But it is not just neuroscientists that feel the brain is more complex than it looks. In 2016, Toronto hosted the TELUS Health Brain Project, a national art exhibit featuring 100 brain sculptures. Just like a real brain, these sculptures are about more than meets the eye. For example, Besedina's inspiration comes from her daughter's life with autism. Francesca used butterflies to represent change and human potential, and Lurch represented humans as synapses connecting the entire world. These artists demonstrate that the brain is also the seat of the mind. Certainly, the brain's outer structures can be rendered artistically, but what about the inside? Can neurons, the cells that run the nervous system, be beautiful too? If you ask the scientists invested in a new artistic movement called neuroart, the answer is a resounding yes. Believe it or not, these breathtaking images were generated using fluorescent microscopes in real experiments and observational studies. By staining different parts of neurons, the dynamic movement of cells becomes visible in a breathtaking spectrum of colors.
There's a big difference between mostly dead and all dead. Mostly dead is slightly alive, or so said Miracle Max in The Princess Bride. I want to tell you about the thanato transcriptome. It refers to postmortem gene expression. Thanato, derived from the Greek word for death, and transcriptome, referring to the process whereby genes are actively switched on or transcribed to make key proteins or enzymes needed by the body. But this happens when the physical body is dead. The dying cells outlive the body and express genes relevant to regulating their death. And this occurs for about a week post-mortem and is used forensically to determine the manner of death and the source of tissue. But interestingly, for the first few days post-physical body death, the cells fight death. There's an upregulation of pro-survival genes with anti-apoptotic or anti-suicidal gene expression peaking around day 5 post-mortem. The strongest fight is seen in the prostate gland. Maybe an innate survival attempt, a desperate survival attempt for the male reproductive gland to have its final chance to procreate. Eventually, as time progresses, the pro-death signals, the pro-death pathways dominate and the cells begin the dying process. But for this period of about a week, post-mortem, the body is essentially only mostly dead. So the thanatotranscriptome, when being dead means only mostly dead.
Why caused havoc in Lycia and other countries. Then one day, from the sky, a giant winged horse named Pegasus came flying. Bellerophon was riding it, and he started firing arrows at me.
This is the end. Hold your breath and count to ten.
I died. But now, zombies are back, and it's time for me to return. Hello, I'm Steffi, and I'm a chimera. I'm made up of all kinds of cells. Cells from my mother, cells from my twin, and even from my grandparents. Do you know why they tried to kill me? I am associated with cancer. I've seen that the chimerism is associated with tumor invasiveness across the tree of life. So maybe if you find me, you might be able to find cancer. And then you might be able to kill me. Bye.
Just how goddamn bad can it get?
Welcome to our presentation, The Zombifying Mark of the Beast. My name is Katina Michael. I'm a professor in the School for the Future of Innovation in Society at Arizona State University. And I'm joined today by my colleague and husband, Dr. M.G. Michael, formerly of the University of Wollongong, who's a philosopher, historian, and theologian.
Revelation 13, 16 to 18. He calls us all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads, and that no one may buy or sell, except one who has the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. His number is 666.
In Revelation chapter 13, 16 to 18, St. John, the seer of Patmos, describes a time in which people will have an existential decision to make on whether or not to adopt the mark of the beast. This mark would be a requirement for one to be allowed to engage in commerce, that is, buying and selling. Denying the mark would lead to suffering persecution by way of exclusion from the marketplace, including diverse discrimination. Now, the mark is a parody on Jesus Christ's seal of baptism. The seal is evidence of belonging to the community of believers, the communio sanctorum, both the living and the dead. And the mark contains a number, 666. And is not necessarily physical or even visible. The vital aspect of this mark, literally in Greek, charagma means a mark that is engraved, etched, branded, cut, or imprinted, is that it would be required for any kind of economic transaction. And so our analogy to zombification of the marked is a total enslavement of the will and conscience. These individuals, according to the author of the Revelation, will be unable to revert back to their former selves, thus being zombified.
She's afraid. She knows I look in the windows. She knows I'm trying to find a way in. We all are. It's no secret anymore. Everyone knows we are out here. Waiting. We're everywhere. In the air. In the water. And for a while they thought we lived on everything. Forever. Those were good times. The fear was as thick and solid as a rock. She won't come out anymore. Not without protection. But there are plenty left. I'll look in their windows, and we may leave the house with their noses in the air. I'll be there.
Hello everyone, I'm Steffi and I'm a postdoctoral research scholar at Arizona State University. And this is something I drew in February when the coronavirus started becoming a thing in the US. I usually fill up the paper with circles, but I was tired and thought I'd leave it as it is, as we don't know when the pandemic is going to end. Also, if we turn it round and round, we can see a face. Two eyes and the mouth. This shows the fear in us when we hear about the coronavirus. And this fear is in every angle, from every perspective, in every culture across the world. I call this artwork Chasing the Coronavirus. As you can see, there is not a clear direction in our movements. We don't know where to go. Which direction is best to avoid the coronavirus? But no matter the direction we choose, it seems to be everywhere in the world. And as you can see, there is lots of variation in the response of people. Some do social distancing, while others are clustered together. But what prevails everywhere, in every angle, is anxiety, fear, and chaos. I'm Steffi, and this is my artwork in the apocalypse. Thank you.
Have you listened to hip-hop recently? She say I'm insane, yeah, I'ma blow my brain out, Sandy help the pain, yeah, please. 5 or 6 pills in my right hand, codeine runs over on my nightstand. Marlene costs more than your rent, your mom still live in a tent, I did have a sand, 13 hours till I land. There's promethazine and Xanax all over, lean act drank, scissor up Sandy's buzzers, benzos. They're in the lyrics, the visuals, and the rapper's self-presentations. On a physiological level, it's easy to see who just popped a sand or took some sips of lean, as both substances have an overall down-regulating effect.
The brain is slowed down and an I don't give a fuck indifference sets in. There's a disturbance of the motoric system that leads to dragging movements and coordination problems. And the speech center is also affected, which leads to articulation difficulties and the so-called mumbling.
Aren't those exactly the phenomenological characteristics of a zombie?
Brainless, unable to speak, motoric clumsiness and an overall slowness. Fully under the control of pharmaceuticals. Are rappers the modern day zombies?
Maybe there's an ongoing self-zombification taking place in hip-hop. With the help of Sannies and Lean, more and more hip-hoppers shut down their brains, reduce their motoric and rhetoric functions to a bare minimum, and subject themselves to the control of these substances.
Maybe the zombie apocalypse isn't something that's accidentally caused by a virus or so, but something that we actively seek for and that we're medicating our way towards.
Hello, I hope everyone is doing well. My name is Kaylee Draper. I am a research assistant in Dr. Octopus's Cooperation Conflict Lab. Now, when I think about zombies and zombie media, I typically think about zombie fictional novels and the wide variety there are out there in the world. And so I've compiled a list of zombie-themed novels that will hopefully be on ZAM's website if it is not already. The wide variety of zombie novels include works such as The Brain Eater's Bible by J.D. McGuhl. This work is told from the perspective of the zombie, and it's about how to be a zombie. And then you have more dread-inducing and horror-themed works, such as Autumn by David Moody, which really stress like that traditional horror feel. What's interesting about a lot of these works is that they use zombies as a vehicle to discuss other issues, like real-world issues, mental health issues, political issues, and zombies are just a really useful tool in order to do this, and I thought that was very fitting of today's ZAM meeting in general, and how zombie literature can reflect that.
I'm here with you today to talk about a course called Apocalypse Survival, Making General Biology Sexy. Apocalypse Survival was a freshman seminar in general science credit at an institution I used to teach at in West Virginia. The purpose of this course was to learn how to be a successful college student and survive. The lecture course covered various topics such as being prepared, man-made disasters, and natural disasters, all of which were relevant towards general biology courses or general human biology topics. The lab component consisted of hypothesis testing, which mask effectiveness is very popular today, and we also did a design, create, and test your own project. We also hosted humans versus zombies on campus. We had many zombies by the end. If you're interested in teaching one of these courses, feel free to shoot me an email and I will help you design it. Until next time, goodbye.
Hello from the Virus Social Behavior Wing of the Northern Arizona Research Bunker. I'm Dr. G. Blue Brazelton. Since the beginning of the pandemic, my team has been trying to predict how human social behavior may affect the spread and danger of this virus, while some of our peers are doing great work with treatment and vaccine research. Here, our team are researching the various formal guidelines and policies which may help us see some normalcy while also limiting virus spread. We have various articles and reports ready to go, but with these remaining seconds, I'd rather speak to the need for cynicism and skepticism of any policies which seek to define or control individual behavior. By examining school reopening plans, specifically plans that require students to leave the safety of their fortified units and physically enter into crowded learning environments, we found that policies intended to limit virus spread are only effective if the sample is 100% compliant. Even a few percentage points of individuals not wearing the protective gear, not giving themselves enough space when around the potentially infected, and following minimal sanitation protocols, it creates an infection point for the entire sample. And once a viable viral load enters into the sample, the likelihood of exponential infections increases significantly. And we're working on hard numbers, but we've learned early on in our research that people do not describe their own behavior accurately, whether inadvertent or intentionally. We need to adopt realistic expectations about individual safety behavior. We recommend the state and federal governments enact and enforce mandates about safety guidelines. As voluntary compliance, it's just not high enough to help quell the storm.
Hello, my name is Christina, and today we'll talk a little bit about mentoring. Research indicates that successful mentoring relationships help college students develop their professional identity and advance their long-term goals, all while guiding them through transforming capabilities into competencies and skills. Mentoring relationships, perhaps even more so during these apocalyptic times, help college students form meaningful connections and represent an avenue for reaching vulnerable populations, such as first-generation and minority college students. So how can mentors connect with students via digital platforms? At Arizona State University, for example, there is a platform called the ASU Mentor Network where faculty can sign up to connect and chat with students. There are countless apps out there that faculty and students use to connect. Chances are such platforms are available at your university as well, perhaps via departmental initiatives, career services, or student organizations. When it comes to the best practices for mentoring, research suggests that it is important to establish expectations and a formal structure, including how often to meet and what digital tools to use, and set up realistic goals and measure progress, then adjust as needed. And of course, as a mentor, it is crucial to show ongoing support and empathy to your mentees. Would you like to talk more about mentoring? Please don't hesitate to get in touch.
Thank you.
In 2016, I traveled between London and Lisbon. The sleeper train starts in Paris at noon and arrives in Lisbon in the early hours of the next morning, crossing the borders while its occupants sleep. When I embarked, the previous inhabitants of my bunk had left a book in the net that strings along above the sleeper's head. The book was Derrida's collection of lectures of hospitality. I began reading in the soothing rocking of the train and the gathering dusk. The book addresses the question of the foreigner, the stranger, at the level of the individual and of the nation state. The previous occupant had scrawled marginalia, exclamation points and furious underlinings, dog-eared pages. I read with interest. I had just become an immigrant on paper in the United States, a guest, an official alien, conditional on good behavior listed in the fine print of my new papers, while the country from which I'd come was staking a new identity on turning away those that were arriving at its shores. As I turned the pages of the book, I dislodged from somewhere towards the back a folded piece of paper. Slightly glossy to the touch, one side jagged where it had been torn from a larger hole. It was an article about the nematomorpha, or horse hairworm. Here's what the article described. The larva of the zombie parasite nematomorpha develops inside the body of a cricket, eating its way through everything non-essential to the cricket's basic functioning. Once grown, the worm needs to return to water to reproduce. Having eaten its fill and having reduced the cricket to head, shell, and legs, the hairworm begins to secrete mind-controlling substances, driving the cricket towards and then into the closest river or lake. The cricket drowns, and the hairworm emerges from the corpse and swims away to mate. In a particularly romantic twist, this clipping suggests that the hairworm waits for a moonlit night to take over the mind of the cricket, using the reflection of moonlight to guide its host to a watery grave. This year, immobilized by a virus, I traveled instead through hyperlinks, scrolling through my phone in the cold dusk. I came across a paper published by two scientists in Japan who'd been studying this nematomorpha, or horse hairworm. Their research found that when they considered these zombie parasites not just in relationship to the cricket, but to the wider ecosystem, the hairworm became a vital pivot point in the flow of energy. Those crickets leaping into the water provided a food source for an endangered trout, and prevented the trout from eating too many of the bugs, which were food for the local bird population. This paper on the nematomorpha, they said, provided the first quantitative evidence that a manipulative parasite can dramatically alter the flow of energy through and across ecosystems, reimagining the function and possible roles of the parasite. Altering the flow of energy through and across ecosystems. Driving the empty shell of the nation-state to a watery end. I print the findings and imagine when foreign objects are no longer a site of contagion and fear, when travel is possible again, that I will leave it on the seat of a plane, slipped into the bag of the traveller next to me on the bus, distributed among the rooms of a cruise ship just before departure, or once again in the net bag above a bunk, a gift, a clue, an earworm, a potential parasite in this strange shared domestic space of a sleeper train crossing borders in the night.
To start off, I would like to present these incredible micro-etchings and ink paintings by neuroscientist and artist Dr. Greg Dunn. Unfortunately, science often carries the stigma of being boring, and neuroscience is no exception, but Dr. Dunn turns this stereotype on its head. By translating scientific literature into artistic expression, Dr. Dunn shows that scientists can be and are creative. But it is not just neuroscientists that feel the brain is more complex than it looks. In 2016, Toronto hosted the TELUS Health Brain Project, a national art exhibit featuring 100 brain sculptures. Just like a real brain, these sculptures are about more than meets the eye. For example, Besedina's inspiration comes from her daughter's life with autism. Francesca used butterflies to represent change and human potential, and Lurch represented humans as synapses connecting the entire world. These artists demonstrate that the brain is also the seat of the mind. Certainly, the brain's outer structures can be rendered artistically, but what about the inside? Can neurons, the cells that run the nervous system, be beautiful too? If you ask the scientists invested in a new artistic movement called neuroart, the answer is a resounding yes. Believe it or not, these breathtaking images were generated using fluorescent microscopes in real experiments and observational studies. By staining different parts of neurons, the dynamic movement of cells becomes visible in a breathtaking spectrum of colors.
There's a big difference between mostly dead and all dead. Mostly dead is slightly alive, or so said Miracle Max in The Princess Bride. I want to tell you about the thanato transcriptome. It refers to postmortem gene expression. Thanato, derived from the Greek word for death, and transcriptome, referring to the process whereby genes are actively switched on or transcribed to make key proteins or enzymes needed by the body. But this happens when the physical body is dead. The dying cells outlive the body and express genes relevant to regulating their death. And this occurs for about a week post-mortem and is used forensically to determine the manner of death and the source of tissue. But interestingly, for the first few days post-physical body death, the cells fight death. There's an upregulation of pro-survival genes with anti-apoptotic or anti-suicidal gene expression peaking around day 5 post-mortem. The strongest fight is seen in the prostate gland. Maybe an innate survival attempt, a desperate survival attempt for the male reproductive gland to have its final chance to procreate. Eventually, as time progresses, the pro-death signals, the pro-death pathways dominate and the cells begin the dying process. But for this period of about a week, post-mortem, the body is essentially only mostly dead. So the thanatotranscriptum, when being dead means only mostly dead.
I caused havoc in Lycia and other countries. Then one day, from the sky, a giant winged horse named Pegasus came flying. Bellerophon was riding it, and he started firing arrows at me. This is the end. Hold your breath and count to ten. Feel the earth move and then I die. But now, zombies are back, and it's time for me to return. Hello, I'm Steffi, and I'm a chimera. I'm made up of all kinds of cells. Cells from my mother, cells from my twin, and even from my grandparents. Do you know why they tried to kill me? I am associated with cancer. I've seen that the chimerism is associated with tumor invasiveness across the tree of life. So maybe if you find me, you might be able to find cancer. And then you might be able to kill me. Bye.